Voilà. Bonjour tout le monde. Je vais aussi parler en anglais. Mon français, ça va, mais allez, c'est mieux anglais, je pense. Mais si vous avez des questions en français, je vais essayer de répondre en français aussi. Ça, allez, pas de problème. Je reste ici, mais peut-être je vais promener après. Je ne sais pas encore, mais je suis un peu fatigué parce que allez, je suis déjà debout de 4h30 pour venir ici à Strasbourg. Mais j'espère... je suis en train de parler en français maintenant, mais j'espère... d'apprendre quelque chose. Il va être aussi un peu repeat. There will be some things I will repeat you had already in previous presentations. Yeah, sorry for that, but I will skip or will pass much faster. I have moved forward with them. I hope that I can learn some things regarding investigations and cryptocurrency and so on, how we deal with it as law enforcement. Also, something I have to stress out, it's a little bit difficult for me, this topic, because it's public, so some topics I can be only very basic. I can't go deeper in because investigative techniques of police, I can't share it with you because maybe, I don't know, it could abused by maybe some people. It's better to avoid these kinds of things. Okay, so first of all, I will talk a little bit about myself, very short. So I worked 20 years in law enforcement, 11 years in cybercrime, research and development team within the Federal Computer Crime Unit. I'm specialized also in dark web investigations. This is much more my specialty, but cryptocurrencies, I'm dealing also with it. And this is important because they told me that this colloquium, it's important for the international cooperation and so on, which I believe in this kind of field and in the cryptocurrency investigation, international cooperation is very important. And one of the things I'm involved in as action leader, it's Belgium, together with other international law enforcement and international organization. It's an impact project and we are developing a training package regarding dark web and cryptocurrencies. It's for law enforcement only. Sorry for that, but it's only for law enforcement. So the objective is to learn them how to deal with dark web and cryptocurrency investigations. It's a 4-day training. So this is one of the things we do. It's training, train law enforcement people in this field. And believe me, I'm a very busy man. Everywhere, as the moment you have a little bit expertise in cryptocurrency or dark web from everywhere in Europe, also outside of Europe, they would like that you come to have to give a presentation or to give training to law enforcement. So it's a very good business. And there is less expertise, but this is growing now because of all the training and so on. So this is getting in the good direction. So yeah, I provide training for CIPOL and so on. And also, last year, as a kind of hobby, I finished my Master of Law and I wrote a thesis, Capital Gains on Cryptocurrencies. So it's the taxation on cryptocurrencies, because I really like the broad view, only the tax view and the investigative and so on. Okay, so now I'm finished. So first of all, I like also a little bit to have some interaction. So how many cryptocurrencies are there today? Do you have an idea? No. Don't exaggerate. But it's thousands. That's true. So it's right now, this morning, I looked. It was the source of CoinMarketCap. It's one source, but maybe another source will say there are less or more. But it was 3,025. cryptocurrencies. So if we talk about Bitcoin, Bitcoin is one of it, it's the biggest one. But besides Bitcoin, you have also Monero and so on, Ethereum. You have plenty of them. And every day, almost, there are new cryptocurrencies popping up. So above, it's always important as law enforcement perspective in investigative that you recognize the symbols and that you know about what you're talking. So we have there Bitcoin, Monero, Verge, and Zcash. The first one is pseudo-anonymous. Robbie talked about it. And the other three are anonymous or privacy coins. It's better privacy coins. I come back later on this. So here, this is a screenshot of this morning. So I'm even, it was early in the morning, so it's 3028 and not 3025. But the market cap, it's decreasing a bit. It's $204 billion. And the Bitcoin dominance is still 66%. So the biggest part in the cryptocurrencies are Bitcoins. So very fast, it's already discussed, but cryptocurrencies, digital, not regulated, decentralized, so no central authority, pseudonymous or anonymous. Pseudonymity, it's a mix of privacy and transparency. So regarding my presentation, everything is public now, so you may take photos if you want and so on, it's no problem. So it's immutable, so once you do a Bitcoin transaction, if I pay to Mark Bitcoin, so it's in the blockchain, so it can't be changed anymore afterwards, so it's irreversible as well. Cross-border, international, important, but very important for us, all transactions are in a public ledger. So regarding Bitcoin, all transactions are in a public ledger. So from the very beginning in 2009 till today, so every transaction you can verify, it's in the blockchain. But it's the Bitcoin address you see, and you don't see an entity. It's not like, okay, this Bitcoin address, it's equal Marc Simon. It's just a Bitcoin address. So who is behind? That's the way of the pseudonymous. And that's one thing. This I'm not going to discuss anymore. So it's the AMLD5. The definition of virtual currencies is inside this directive. Okay, so now the criminal use of Bitcoins. So there are plenty of them. For example, I didn't mention here, but you have also, if I'm right, there are also already people, and this is scam, there is a lot of scam in the field of cryptocurrency. So even we discussed about Libra coin, the Facebook coin, but people were already buying them. But it was just fake. They are not there. So you just type in Google and you type in Libra coin if you want to buy it, and then you will see, okay, they are not there. So somebody who is offering it, it's just a scam. So this is a big business, all the scams. But you have also, police, law enforcement, ransomware, it's a lot. Robbie talked about it, extortion. So especially trade of illicit goods, so on darknet marketplaces, the dark web, you can buy whatever you want, but most of the time you have to pay with bitcoins or other cryptocurrencies, money laundering, and so on. So you have plenty of things. For example, ransomware. You had very big ransomware cases in the past, but also nowadays. I give a few examples. NotPetya was the one, but so a ransomware case, so if you arrive at university, for example, and you want to start your computer and it doesn't work and there is a screen like this or like that, which is saying that all files are encrypted. So if you want to buy a decryption key, you have to pay Bitcoin to have back to receive a decryption key with which you can decrypt the information that's encrypted by the criminals. So if you see this, this is always a big issue. It can arrive at your home, but it can arrive at university, it can arrive in a company. But this is very hard because sometimes a lot of things are encrypted. And then, yeah, okay, they say, okay, you have to pay Bitcoin or something else, and then you can get the decryption key. And this is, there are many investigations regarding ransomware throughout Europe, throughout the world. Yeah, this is a very big business for criminals. Also, at right side, you see an example of another ransomware campaign, WannaCry or cybercrime campaign. And there you will see they talk about money laundering at the right side. So at one time, the bitcoins they received were converted in another cryptocurrency. It was Monero. And Monero, it's, yeah, Bitcoin is pseudo-anonymous. Monero, they tell it's privacy coin. This is yeah, very hard to do something with it. I come back on it. So ransomware as a service, this is for me and for many colleagues very important because there is a lot of money earned with it. And it's also quite easy. So even with less skills, now you will say, okay, you have to be a computer specialist, you have to be good skills. But yeah, some of these things are called ransomware as a service. So you just can buy a package on dark web and so on. And then you can start for yourself as an affiliate or something. For example, there at below, you had the ransomware Gantcrab. So this was an also another ransomware campaign. You have plenty of ransomware campaigns. This one, to give you an idea, the screenshot, maybe you can't read, but it's just telling after a big year that they are retiring. They earned $2 billion because of their criminal business model, so ransomware as a service. So yeah, many people made use of their ransomware, so they earned a lot of money. Themselves, they had like $150 million earned with it. And then they say, okay, this is an easy way to earn money. And now we will retire, and all the money is invested already in legal business and so on. So they are quite proud. So this is the announcement. So this is one of our concerns. For the, there are some other screenshots. But again, it's not always bad. I don't know if you heard about No More Ransom. This is also international project from. So this is an international corporation project as well. So this means if you, this is a platform with many partners, many law enforcement agencies are there. It's from Europol, but together with many other law enforcement, like Belgium is also involved in it. Also private companies, security companies, who are also helping in the decryption of ransomware. So this platform is very important for law enforcement, but also for victims. So if you are a victim, for example, of Gantcrab, which I was telling about, so at the other side, they try to find also techniques if you are infected with encryption, that at one point of a time, they will become a decryptor to decrypt your files just through accessing the site, which is offered by Europol, law enforcement, and private companies. Then you will get the decryptor, and then you can decrypt your files. So for example, if you are infected with the ransomware today, so you can just check the website. Maybe you don't have to pay. Maybe there is already a decryptor. Or if you are infected with it, and you say, okay, well, I can wait, maybe I wait some weeks, months, something like that, or you let the system outside, and then maybe a few weeks later there will be a decryptor. So this is also an international initiative, which is very helpful. Its training is already international, and this is also very international with public, private sector, and so on involved. So it's very good. This one, it's related to dark web. It was a takedown of Alpha, Bay, and Hansa markets. Why I'm showing this, this is also two big marketplaces on the dark web where you can buy drugs and other illicit things. Both marketplaces were taken down. You see many logos on the thing, so this is also through international cooperation. On marketplaces, on dark web, in most of the cases you have to pay, you have to pay with cryptocurrency, mostly Bitcoin. So if you want to buy drugs on the dark web, so it's with Bitcoin. It's not with the credit card or something. It's like this. Okay, this was also already told, I guess. So the Bitcoin business, this is important for us because these are our exit or entry points. I come back to the exit and entry point. So exchanges, debit card providers, payment processing, what's that? Yeah, if you go to a shop and you can pay with Bitcoin, so there is a payment provider or processing system behind. Mining pools, ATM providers, all of these makes part of the Bitcoin business and can be useful for us. Also taking into account the know your customer, so regarding AML, D5 and so on. So if you, I don't know if people are here in the group who have already bought cryptocurrencies. Are there people who have bought already cryptocurrencies? No one? Ah, okay, yeah. So, yeah, this is just a personal tip, but I say it always during the trainings. So if you need to talk about cryptocurrency investigations and so on, yeah, just buy some of them and then you will experience a lot. Then you will have to go to a Bitcoin exchange, and then they will ask, okay, personal information from you. Maybe you have to take a selfie, you have to provide an identity card, you have to provide proof of residence and so on. And the more amount you want to trade, the more things you have to give them. So this is already a big collection of information they are asking from you. And at the other way, if you buy it, so you can just buy for 20 euros cryptocurrency, it doesn't make any, you can buy it for 5 and then you can send it to a Bitcoin wallet and you can convert it to Monero and so on. So then you practice it for yourself and then you understand more how the whole thing is working and how which things you need and which things are asked. So this is always a nice tip with a lot of money, and if you're lucky, like now Bitcoin is decreasing a lot lately, so maybe you will be happy also within a few years. I don't know. Okay, so important for us is, so as I told you, so all transactions are recorded. So blockchain, it's everything is recorded. So this means you can search through the blockchain with a lot of blockchain explorers. So all transactions are there. This is something I'll come back to it. But first of all, as entry and access point, so if you want to buy cryptocurrencies, you can buy them to exchange, I told already, but also face-to-face. You can meet people who sell Bitcoin. So then you can say, okay, here is my mobile phone. You can send it to this Bitcoin address on my mobile phone, mobile wallet, and I pay you in cash. But you can sell goods and also ATM. You have a lot of ATMs. For example, there's an ATM in Strasbourg. No, it's not in Strasbourg. it's a little bit further than Strasbourg. In France, I didn't find a lot of ATMs, I think. But normally, if you go to this website, Coin ATM Radar, wherever you go in the world and you say, okay, I would like to buy Bitcoins or other cryptocurrency, even you have ATMs where you can buy Monero. You just check the website and then you will see what you can buy and then you can put cash money in it with your mobile phone. You get cryptocurrencies in your mobile wallet. So that's something you can do. Now it's a little bit going deeper in the technical point of view. So this is important. So as I told, all transactions are public. So for investigative purposes, it's already important if they come to me and they say, okay, we have to pay bitcoins on this address. Can you invest it? Can you follow the money? Can you see where it's going and so on? Entry point, exit points. And then, yeah, you just go to blockchain.com, for example. You check in a blockchain expert and say, okay, yeah, the address exists, but there are no transactions yet. So it's finished. So you don't have to do anything because there is nothing. And this is often the case. So because a lot of people, there is an extortion, sextortion, ransomware, and they go to the police and they say, okay, we have to pay on this address. But for many cases, for every client or victim, they create a new Bitcoin address. And if they don't pay it, there is nothing to trace because there is no transaction. So this is already important to start with as a first point of investigation. The most common thing you have in cryptocurrency transaction, it's like one input address and two output address. So the things you see here at the left side and right side is our Bitcoin addresses. So for instance, Mark says to me, okay, pay me one Bitcoin. So at the left side you have my Bitcoin address and at the right side you have his Bitcoin address. And often if I have to pay him, for example, 0.5, and on that address is one Bitcoin, so the one Bitcoin will go to two addresses, 0.5 to his address of payment, and then 0.5 to a second address. And the second address is a change address. It's like you give 20 euro, and you have to pay 15 euros, so you get back 5 euros, and the 5 euros are coming on a change address. A change address, that's also an address that's belonging to the same person, the same entity. This is called already a form of clustering. So this is already a technique of investigating. So this means that the change address and the input address are belonging to the same person, to the same entity. This way, it's the way you can go forward to investigate cryptocurrencies, to collect as much as possible addresses related to one person, to one entity, and the more you have, then you can see other interactions with, for example, entry and exit points, which I discussed before. Also interesting, so below you have the first Bitcoin transaction ever. This is the genesis of Bitcoin, so the start of Bitcoin in 2009, 50 Bitcoin. Were sent. This was the first mined Bitcoin. This was the first mining, and then the creator of it received 50 Bitcoins. Now, if you want to mine, Robbie told about it. So you earn 12.5 Bitcoins as a miner as a reward plus the transaction fees, which are in the mined block. But to mine. In the past, you could do that on your own personal computer a long time ago. Some people are still trying to find their old computer somewhere because they throw him away 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago, and they mine Bitcoins, for example, with 10 or 20 or 100 Bitcoins. But yeah, then it was nothing worth, but now it's a lot of money worth. So, but also it's much difficult to mine. So if you want to mine it, you need a big infrastructure. It costs a lot of money to succeed. So you have mining pools now also. So this is with joint efforts with a lot of computers together to mine blocks and so on, mining farms. And there was no new mining farm becoming, I think, operationable in Texas. I thought it was the biggest one very, very recently, yeah. Okay, blockchain, I'm not going to talk anymore. We know what it is. So in a blockchain, the only thing I want to mention is, so every block contains many transactions. So the transaction you saw with one input address, the output and the change address, so this is a transaction. So you can have 1,000 transactions in one block. And this is the block that is mined, and it's like every 10 minutes there is a block mined. Okay, so now investigating cryptocurrencies. So first of all, we have the follow the money approach. We have OSINT, open source intelligence. We have some techniques, clustering, as I told already, so change and multi-input clustering. And the attribution, I will explain. We have open source tools and we have commercial tools, and also potential identification. So mainly the investigations are performed are Bitcoin investigations. Also, before I forgot, so a recent study of Chainalysis said that dark web and cryptocurrency, it's like 1 billion. There is 1 billion of cryptocurrency used in dark web. And this is also important, this was also in their report, less than 1% of Bitcoin, it's for criminal use. This was the source of Chainalysis. So if we think, okay, all Bitcoins are criminal use, so probably it's not the case. And also another slide, this is the last slide, but it's quite important. It's another company, CipherTrace. It's also a blockchain analysis company. And there, the CEO announced in an interview that 95% of criminal use of cryptocurrency, it's Bitcoin or Ethereum. So 95, so 5% is probably the rest. Okay, so as I told you many times, it's public searchable, but you have also other cryptocurrencies like Monero, privacy coins, and this is much harder because Monero is not it's not public searchable. It's privacy coin. It's much harder. So here some slides with examples. I tried to make some beautiful things. I'm not the best. I'm not so good in this kind of things. But as you can see, if they arrive to me and they ask me, okay, so this is the suspect address, this is the suspect, and this is, okay, what can you do? And then we try to have a look at the follow the money, the follow the Bitcoin, and so on. And then we see a kind of this, and there we see an exit point. An exit point can be an exchange, a Bitcoin payment service, an ATM, and so on. It can be a lot of things. So the objective is, if you have a suspect with a pseudo-anonymous Bitcoin address, so you have to get to see where there is a potential of money cashed out or Bitcoins converted in cash. So this is quite relevant for investigation. So Franks, this is an example I can give. Imagine the suspect address is, for example, this one. It's the Bitcoin address of WikiLeaks, starting with 3.6 and so on. So this can be found open source. A lot of things can be found open source. This is not the example of WikiLeaks, but okay, you have a Bitcoin address, you Google it, and then you see, oh, it's a Bitcoin address of WikiLeaks. So you can check the balance on that address, so I would do that. So if you see, okay, it's zero, but also, and this is a little bit more technical, it can be, if it's a Bitcoin address, so this is more for the technic guys here who have more understanding of it. But if it's, for example, a Bitcoin address which was there already before a fork, a hard fork, a split of Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash, so this means that the private key is the same of both. So it can be that there is no Bitcoin, but there can be maybe something else on it. So this is also something that can be relevant. And you have monitoring tools as well to monitor the Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies. Also here, I would like to say regarding the example I showed, I will come back to it in a few examples, but additional to that, from the suspect to the exit point, we can perform some techniques to have a better view of the picture. This is a very easy picture. In reality, it will be much more complex. So, for instance, you can use clustering or attribution. So clustering, that's the thing I explained with change addresses, but you can also do it with multi-input. I show you how multi-input work, and if you can cluster the things, so this means the dots you saw on my scheme, I will try to make less dots and then come straight to an exit point. So if I can, if I have five dots and I don't know which it is, and I can say, okay, these five dots are the same entity, and one of the five dots has a link to an exit point, so this can be useful. And then it can be attributed, so this means attributed, so that will say, if you have five dots, five Bitcoin addresses, you cluster them to one entity, and then you know one of the five is the one of WikiLeaks, then you can say, okay, all others in the same clusters are also of WikiLeaks. So this is the attribution step. And the entry and the exit points, these are important, I told you already, so it could be exchange and other Bitcoin businesses. So now I to show you on the slides, because I guess some of you, even if I'm talking English, but maybe you think I'm talking Russian or something, I don't know, because it's so I can imagine that some things are quite complex, like clustering and attribution and so on, but okay, I hope you can sleep. So here, for example, left, right, two Bitcoin transactions. You saw already a transaction on the slide with one input and two output addresses. So for instance, I have to pay Mark Bitcoins. So I pay Mark Bitcoins, and to pay the Bitcoins, for example, I have to pay Mark one Bitcoin. And on my address A, there is one, and on my address B, there is two. So both addresses will be used to pay him two Bitcoins, one and two. So it's three in total. Two will send out, two will go to him, and one will come back to a change address. Maybe this could be C, or no, it could be F or G, but don't mind this. So later I do another transaction with Bitcoin address B and C to Sebastian. So I pay him also the same amount, and then that's the first thing. So I have done two transactions, and one transaction has two input addresses, A and B, and the other one has also two input addresses, B and C. What do you think can be done next? So it's called multi-input, so this means everything that's starting from the left side input can be linked or can be clustered, sorry, to the same entity. So what do you think? Is it all the same person who is doing the transaction, or are two different entities? Who thinks it's the same? Of course, yeah. So as I told, A and B, two Bitcoin addresses, I pay to Mark. B and C, I pay to Sebastian. So because the B is common, so this means I have control over Bitcoin address B, which is the same private key I have control over. So because of that, you can say, okay, A, B, B, C, this is to the same entity, but all of them are to the same entity. And now comes the attribution. Imagine that we know that C is the 3.6 WikiLeaks Bitcoin address. So, okay, what I learned about it? So there was somebody say, okay, the suspect address is C. And then, okay, I managed to say, all right, but C, entity C has also Bitcoin address B and A. The suspect address was A, for example, but I managed to see that there was also B and C, and with C, OSINT, for example, I found out it was WikiLeaks. So this means that all these addresses belong to WikiLeaks, but it can belong to another important, So once more, if I start, I can stop with the change and clustering and no. But for example, this is a question. In the first one, now you are all becoming experienced. But which one is the change address? Do you think it's the 3.4 or the 0.6? And why 0.6? Yeah, that's right. So this is how it works. So you have multi-input and change. For example, if you have to pay only 0.6, then you won't use 4 times 1 Bitcoin. You just use 1 Bitcoin to pay the 0.6. No, because you have to use 4 times 1 Bitcoin. So 4 different Bitcoin addresses, which when multi-input techniques are used, clustering techniques. So this means this is the same entity plus. You know that 3.4 is the payment and the 0.6 is the change. So the change can be also added there. So then you know that these 5 addresses are belonging to the same entity. There are some exceptions. I'm not going to go in this because this is too technical. But if you know, for example, the 0.6 Bitcoin address, if you know it's attributed to a known entity, then you know that the other address are belonging to the same entity. This is a little bit the technique. This is, I'm not going to talk here. So now some obfuscation techniques. So of course it's all easy. It sounds easy, but it's not so easy as it sounds. But it's coming more complex in reality as well, because you have also obfuscation techniques which can make it more difficult. So the using of mixing techniques, centralized, decentralized mixings, coin join, and privacy coins. So the mixing techniques or the obfuscation of transaction, it's meant to try to break the linkability and the traceability of the follow the money. I have a very easy, nice example later, so it will explain it very clearly. And the coin join, so that's multiple parties join transaction together at the left side to protect their privacy and perform a transaction. So this is used, of course, also by criminals. It's harder to de-anonymize, but that's all the thing. Always I say anonymity is relative, I say always. So if they ask me, is it possible, is it impossible, for me, everything is relative. Okay. So the identification of a mixer could be also important, of course. And the methods, it's centralized, decentralized. I give you an example about that. And also coin join. And also you have increased use of privacy-focused cryptocurrencies. For example, on darknet marketplaces recently, some marketplaces which are doing business and illicit goods and so on, some of them accept also Monero or other cryptocurrencies. Also the Gantcrab, for example, they accept also Dash. It's not only Bitcoin, but also Dash. It's not always Bitcoin. And some altcoins have mixing features. So this is an example of a mixing, centralized. So what I'm talking about that, it's very easy. So I'm the owner of address A, and I want to pay on address, and my address is D. I have 2 addresses, A and D. But I would like to break the traceability, the linkability. So B and C, it's a mixer, for example. So this is something that's put in between. That's somebody who is offering the service. So this means I pay to the address of mixer, Bitcoin address B of the mixer 0.5. There is a small fee that the mixer is taking because he is earning money of it. And then he sent less more a little bit less to an address I provided. So if you have to do this through blockchain analysis and so on, as you can imagine, this is getting more difficult. And these are some techniques, easy techniques, which are put in place. But as I told you, nothing is impossible. So these are examples of mixes on the dark web. You have plenty of them. Money laundering, it's also they make use of casinos, online casinos, to launder bitcoins, and so on. And here I have it's somebody, a colleague of me, who made this nice presentation because it's about money laundering. So you have the placement, the layering, and the integration. So the placement in cryptocurrencies can be so darknet marketplaces like Hansa, Alphabay. So if you earn money by selling goods, illicit goods. So if you send them the money to an exchange, it can be the placement of in the money laundering scheme. And the layering can be adding anonymity through mixing and privacy coins. And the integration can be afterwards that you laundered the proceeds in the real legal economy. Okay, privacy cryptocurrency, I'm almost finished. So this is, for example, Monero, Verge, it's, and so on. You have plenty of them. And this is my last slide, and this is one of the concerns, like Robbie was also talking about Monero at the end. First of all, the CEO of CyberTrace, this is a photo I took, a screenshot I took this morning. So FTF's regulation to push criminals to privacy coins, so like Monero and so on. And then this is on a very good source, but this is a source related to all Darknet news, but I'm not going to share the source, but well, it's Darknet Live, it's mentioned there. But their German official claim Monero is untraceable. And this is of October 22, so it's quite recent, but this is one of the concerns. So you have Bitcoin, pseudo-anonymous, but of course, international effort, we succeed more and more in doing good things, but of course, there is a lot of work still that needs to be done. And then we have some issues that are popping up also, as you can see on this slide. So, okay, this is my presentation for now. So, go ahead with the questions.
Hello. Merci Christophe pour cette présentation très complète et très descriptive du fonctionnement des bitcoins. Et j'avais plusieurs questions à te poser, mais on est un peu limité dans le temps, donc j'en poserai qu'une seule. Ne serait-il pas intéressant, au niveau européen, que nous ayons une base de données pour les services de police qui regroupe justement toutes ces informations, comme il existe aux États-Unis, IceCream, qui permet de recenser la plupart des sites illégaux et qui est disponible à toutes les forces de l'ordre?
Yes, I think the more we share things, and the more the more we can share information, the more things we can collect, and also in training and investigation and so on, the better results we will have. But it's something. From my opinion, it's something we have to put in place, like universal for the whole world. Maybe there will always be countries who are not willing to help or less help us, and so on. So the more, first of all, what's important, it's okay, understand what's going on, so the awareness, so the more people are getting trained and know how it works, so the more things could be collected, the better, the more things are shared, the better they're shared. So the much more information there is, and the much more information there is, the better it could help the investigations.
D'accord. Donc je te poserai peut-être des questions, si on a encore le temps, tout à l'heure, qui peuvent intéresser tout le monde. Donc là, je vais donner peut-être deux questions pour la salle, pour pouvoir passer ensuite à la troisième table ronde.
Alors oui, deux petites questions, parce qu'on est déjà en train de mordre sur le créneau de la table ronde 3. Donc, monsieur. Et monsieur.
Merci beaucoup. J'aimerais juste un avis qualitatif, parce qu'on a vu plein de techniques qui essayent de retracer les criminels, etc. Mais à la fin, une petite phrase qui dit « Mais de toute façon, il y a certaines monnaies qu'on ne pourra pas tracer. » Actuellement, est-ce que c'est très très dur, c'est pratiquement impossible, ou alors on arrive quand même à faire certaines choses parce que les criminels se plantent, ou on en met bien juste un avis général sur où est-ce qu'on en est.
Non, mais je vais répondre en français maintenant. Changer. Oui, c'est où ce qu'on est. Pour commencer, oui, il y a. Allez, moi je pense nous sommes. Ça donne de plus en plus de résultats. Alors nous sommes dans la bonne direction. Au niveau de law enforcement, des services police, parce qu'aussi, allez, comme j'ai dit, de plus de personnes, des collègues qui sont capables à comprendre qu'est-ce qui se passe, et les techniques que j'explique ici, il y a plus de possibilités pour aussi avoir des résultats. Hein. Ça, c'est aussi. Pas seulement en Belgique ou en France, mais si tout le monde apprend ça, alors c'est un bénéfice pour beaucoup. Encore, oui, le crypto-monnaie privacy coins, ça c'est un souci, hein, comme Monero, hein, comme tu vois là. Ouais, c'est. Allez, moi je ne dis pas. Je ne vais pas dire que ça ne vaut pas la peine, c'est impossible. Moi, je dis que c'est très dur, mais je ne peux pas aller plus loin, mais allez, pour moi, rien n'est impossible. Mais évidemment, ça devient de plus en plus difficile quand on utilise certaines monnaies. Et je vais aussi encore ajouter, il y a aussi déjà des bureaux d'échange qui ont dit voilà, certains crypto-monnaies comme Monero, on n'accepte plus. Hein? Ça, c'est aussi quelque chose qui passe. Ça, c'est une autre direction. Peut-être il y a encore plus et si tout le monde dit voilà on n'accepte plus ça devient difficile pour encore
Alors je me permettrai d'ajouter quelque chose. Moi je déteste qu'on dise que c'est intraçable. Je dirais plutôt que c'est actuellement intraçable. Parce que tout laisse des traces sur Internet. Simplement, il faut pouvoir les décrypter. Et actuellement, on n'a pas les technologies pour les décrypter. Mais il faut savoir qu'en informatique, ça va très vite. Et dans quelques mois, il y aura des moyens pour les décrypter, tels l'intelligence artificielle, l'utilisation du blockchain. Et peut-être, grâce à Google, l'ordinateur quantique qu'on devrait voir d'ici une dizaine d'années, je l'espère.
Du coup, c'était pour savoir qu'est-ce qu'il faudrait faire pour tracer genre un criminel qui utilise Monero, par exemple.
Ça, c'est bien. Merci.
Non, mais tu peux encore une fois... Oui.
Comment tracer ?
Tu demandes s'il y a un suspect qui utilise Monero. Comment le tracer ? Oui, c'est le problème. Hein. C'est... ouais. Et comme vous avez, allez, quand moi je dois payer Monero à une adresse à toi, Monero adresse, oui, allez, comme j'ai dit, dans le blockchain Bitcoin c'est public, dans le blockchain Monero il y a pas beaucoup de données qui sont publiques et là ça devient déjà difficile à voir, peut-être le montant n'est pas publié, pas l'adresse où tu as payé. Alors ça arrête là déjà, ça arrête pas, mais ça devient déjà difficile pour faire une investigation. Mais quand même, allez, Je dis rien n'est impossible.
Et je pense qu'en faisant du retroengineering sur justement le code de génération de Monero, on pourrait peut-être trouver une astuce pour essayer de récupérer justement les adresses de sortie entrantes et faire comme pratique les Suédois, faire une comparaison entre ce qui a été acheté et ce qui a été vendu en monnaie virtuelle et pouvoir ainsi identifier les transactions aberrantes.
Merci. Voilà. Avec plaisir.